But the greatest model of prayer is what I want to share with us. So whatever you are bringing in, or whatever style of prayer or revelation, let it come into bearing with this model. Shall we open our Bibles this evening? The Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter number 6. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Matthew, chapter number 6. I will read to us from verse 9 down to 15. If you are there, let me hear you say yes.
Yes, sir.
In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. He didn't say pray this prayer. He said, in this manner, pray, which means it's a prayer pattern. And for every of the statement, there's a model. Not just reciting it. You may recite it like a benediction. You can take any passage of the scripture as your benediction. But this is Jesus said, let me teach you how to pray. The dynamics of prayer. And there is no other person that knows better than Jesus. Now he says, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, thank you for the quickening of your word. Lord Jesus, we thank you for our salvation. We thank you for the Christ you have paid. We thank you for being the embodiment of mercy that surpasses judgment, by which today we are free and we have become the children of light. Lord, as we go into your word, I ask that your word, the illumination of your word, divine utterance, and the grace to assimilate your word and comprehend the principles you are about to teach without any controversy. Lord, let it flow. Thank you, precious Father. Who bound the devil and his sword and all the scheming and device of the wicked world. I say you have no part nor lot in any of these, to the glory and honor of the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Now, when you look at the passage, from verse 9 of chapter 6 to verse 15, can be subdivided into 7 primary responsibilities. The first one says, pray in this manner, that hallowed be your name. Now, from chapter 9 to 16, I beg your pardon, read prayer is purposely focusing your mind and concentrating. Praying without distraction. Praying with absolute focus. Your mind, heaven is established in your heart. Your mind is towards your maker, and the process of your mind is what Jesus paid over 2,000 years ago. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The tabernacle of our peace was laid upon him by his stripes that we made whole. So himself took up our infirmity. So the remedy, every asset I have for my prayer to be answered, and the right of ownership by redemption is focused on the cross. So everything takes its source from the cross. Everything was settled on the cross. And the delivery was given on the cross. Because the Bible tells us in Ephesians 1:3, blessed be the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has made available for us all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. But I now access by faith, I receive through my belief. What Jesus taught his disciples before the manifestation of the Holy Spirit in his fullness in the life of all our church. And now says, pray in this manner. Now, how can I pray for long hours? You know, sometimes if you leave somebody alone, apart from just praying in tongues, which is building up yourself in your most holy faith, and then praying Holy Ghost and praying in unknown tongues. But if you leave someone that's okay, I want to leave you for the next 5 hours, and then I want you to pray. You can be saying the same thing, and after a while you look at your watch, it becomes boring. So how do I endure in prayer? How do I position myself in the place of prayer, that I can pray prayer and have answers? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So another thing we want to address here is the secret of praying for long from the teaching of Jesus Christ. Another thing we want to address for number 4, that Jesus fasted and prayed for 40 days and he was praying day and night. How was he able to get that done? So the way he was praying, after crusade, he will go alone on the mountaintop and pray. Very early in the morning, before anybody wakes up among the disciples, he's already awake and he's praying. So the disciple came to the point that when you are praying, and things are happening, what? How will teach us this thing so that you can have it? And again, I'm interested in such principles. Then another thing, another point number four, how can Jesus' model be the content and model of our prayer? That is, model by which we can learn the modalities of prayer, order our prayer, and the content of our prayer. So even if I'm meant to pray for 6-7 hours, and I have to do it in 30 minutes, how can I do it in such a way that I know that I'm praying the will of God? Because the words of Jesus, is the word of God, the word of Jesus is the will of God. So if this is the secret of how Jesus prayed and he got results on earth, if I follow that same pattern, I should be able to get results without stress. True or false? So whatever any man, anybody has prayed, no matter the prayer pattern or style, anybody has written any book, if I know if Jesus is my model, is my mentor, and is the one that paid the price for me, and what he says to one, he says to all, and this is what he taught disciples, and I can see the exploits when they added, they allowed the Holy Ghost to take over their prayer model, they become an explosive prayer power. So with the Holy Ghost that I have, and if I have the understanding of his own model, my prayer life changes. And if my prayer life becomes better, my spiritual life is on the right channel. True of us? Now, so today, let's look at one or two. First, let's look at the first passage in Matthew chapter 6, in verse number 9. It says, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now, we need to plan ahead for our praying pattern. Not that today we pray 30 minutes, tomorrow 20 minutes, next week 2 hours, the next day 15 minutes, then for the next 3 days, no time to pray, you will eat and drink. Witchcraft will just put something and then, before you know, afterwards, you know, people who don't pray, God is helping them. All the prayer I'm praying, what is the effect? There is no labor in prayer that's a waste. Not doing it is the problem. And everything about God is the consistency of doing something that releases the results or the power inherent in it. So the first one, let's say there are stages before the concluding something, thy power, thy glory, thy honor, thy kingdom forever and ever, the closing lead. So there are 7 stages. Stage number 1, hallowed be thy name. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now, Father who never be thy name in verse 9. Have a humble heart towards God when praying to him. Have what? A humble heart towards God. Why? James chapter number 4, verses 6 and 7, the Bible tells us that God gives much grace to the humble. He now told us to resist the devil and he will flee from us. So in a humble position, grace and supplication is poured in, and then we're able to come before him. How? Start praising. How do I do this? By start praising and giving thanks for all things that God has done. Now, how can I do this? You know, you have done your praise and worship, but now you want to now hallow his name. If open your Bible with me to Genesis chapter 1. If you look at Genesis chapter 1, I want to hallow God's name. The Bible tells us in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, that the earth was now formed and void. That is, it was shapeless, not what God expected, and it was empty. And the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord, he moved and moved over the face of the waters and over the face of the deep. And the word of the Lord went forth better than the light, and that was light. Then in verse 4, he now told us about the creation of the firmament, and God saw the light, and it was good. And God divided the light from darkness, and so forth. He talks about the firmament separating the waters, the land from the waters, and then he made the flowers. And some commentators tell us that even the things that we are seeing on earth, almost like 3 feet is available inside water. And then like that, to the point that God now came in verse 26 of Genesis 1, let us make man in our own image and after our own likeness. And now went further to now tell us, he gave man charge after making man. He said, be fruitful, multiply, and replenish the earth. And then made every seed bearing, every fruit, seed bearing, to be after his kind, and every plant, and then every animal to produce after his kind. And he concluded in verse 31 of Genesis 1 that everything God created, he saw that everything he created was very good. Now, in hallowing him, what do I do? I start from Genesis. Oh God, example. Oh God, who created the heavens and the earth, I love you. You made the light out of darkness, I praise you. Oh God, I praise you because you made the firmament in the midst of waters and divided the waters from the waters. I thank you because you made the earth out of the waters so that all the land may bear fruit. I praise you because you made the sun, moon, and stars and set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. Now, from that book of Genesis chapter 1, the beginning of the beginnings and the beginning of creation, the fact that he created, he started the earth, he created creation and made me to rule over it is what exhorting him for. Is that not so? So I'm starting by going back to the formation of the foundation, the basic thing with which God did and placed man in charge. Are you with me? The question I want to ask you, when last did you appreciate God for his creative ability? If praise is to make things happen, and thanksgiving is to thank you for what he has done, those things he has done before you were physically born, have they ever thanked him for it? To hallow is to exalt, to magnify. And when you are magnifying somebody, you are appreciating the value. You are to worship is to add value, the value that is worth. So you are appreciating and acknowledging him for the things he has done. The Bible tells us the heart was not for you, he created. He makes light out of darkness. Then he put the firmament, he placed the sun, the moon, and the stars in place, which we see every day. But we never bother to thank him. Praise the Lord. Even when we have the right brothers who invented the plane, anytime you enter a plane, you salute the God who gave them the wisdom to be able to invent the plane. When you sit on your ball, if a scientist, you remember Thomas Edison, and you salute his courage, his perseverance, and his wisdom to attempt the thing 1,000 times than 1,000 times before he got it done. How much more the Maker? He said, "Our Father, hallowed be thy name." Because everything was created by his name. By who? If they say something is created by Peter, which means by Peter's name, this was created. Is that not so? So hallowed be thy name. How big, how magnificent, how mighty is your name? You that did this. So you are now elogizing, bringing citation of the accreditation of the things he has done to merit that position, of which no man on earth has been able to do, no other God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, in the same flow, you went, you go ahead. Now, I made the firmament to give. I appreciate you because you made the flowers and the fish in the waters, the animals camping all over the ground. I thank you because you made human beings in your own image and gave them the power to rule over this earth. I thank you because you are my creator. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, before coming to self, you see, this model did not bring about rushing into his presence. It's acknowledging everything he has created that is worth it. And I have given what you don't appreciate, you can't assess. True or false? So if I don't appreciate the thing that he has even created by his creative ability, how can he put in me the spirit of creativity for me to produce likewise? Now this thing has to do about value. About value. Assuming this thing is here now, and I'm kicking it, what would you say? Say, pastor has no value for this tool. But I begin to say, you see this tool, there is none like it in this country. It's the best of best. If anybody wants to tamper with this tool, what will you tell him? You want to tamper with pastor. Because this thing is like an idol to him. So as you are magnifying him, you are elogizing him. You are appreciating him. Why? Because before the beginnings of the beginnings, before the foundation of the earth, even before the existence of man, the proof that he has been existing, that he has created creation before creation. If you understand me, just shout hallelujah. Now, after that, you now go into, I thank you because you are my creator. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. That is a consistent God. But you know, today when we are praying, our emphasis and our tempo is on, at times we come before God, that God, are you really true? Are you really real? Because no man has seen God face to face. So are you really real? But if you are real, why have I not eaten since morning? When I'm not even fasting. Why is it that I couldn't pay my rent if you are real? God, why is it that if you are this, why is this going to happen to me? But the point there is because the way I'm feeling does not make God not to be God. Even if I thank God, God, I'm not going to preach again, I'm going to be a pastor, I'm not going to serve, I'm not going to backslide, I'm going to be a greatest. I'm going to say there's no God. That was God's stop God from not being God. Is that not so? If I say, God, if you don't make this church 115,000 by the end of this quarter, I will call it quit. If I quit, that does not stop God from not being God. Am I communicating? So the basis of why should I threaten him? So if I know that he's a beggar, he's the author and the finisher of all things, then I should assess him and relate with him with humility. I should not harass him, I should not threaten him, I should come before him, first of all, appreciating creation and nature. That's why a believer who has understanding of value for creation will not have problem. The why he will have problem is because even ordinary flower, or he watches a butterfly, or an insect rather, pollinating a flower plant to bring forth fruit, he will look at it and appreciate the wonders of God. So when such a person wants to approach God, no matter the pressure, no matter the pain, he will still spend the quality time appreciating God. And let me tell you, nobody appreciates you that expresses it that you don't care for. You know what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 12? He said that whatever you want others to do to you, the message emphasis says, you take the first initiative. That is, do the same to others. If I'm complaining that nobody is shaking my hand, nobody is greeting me, nobody like smiling at me, if I start at the door and I start smiling at everybody and shaking hand, whatever I show, I mean, unbelievers will say, nemesis will catch up. In church with God, among believers, we say, whatever a man sow, so shall he reap. Unbelievers will say, nemesis will catch up. What is for nemesis will catch up? Whatever you do this side, somebody else will do for you on the other side. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, I thank you because you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to redeem me from eternal destruction. Now, from thanking him for creating you and for his creation, you started by what he had done in the beginning. Because in the beginning, he had us that form and body, he recreated. If you are not recreated it, you won't be there. Now that you are there, you appreciate it. You now graduate to your creation. Thereafter, you now move into your redemption. Because before you were saved, it was not from your mother's womb that you were saved, true or false. Even if you are born by the most righteous woman being on earth, you have to still go through the process of the tempting with the heart man believes unto righteousness and with the mouth of passion explain unto salvation, true or false. Until that is done, one is not yet born again. That's the model that is like. So in the same light, I'm now appreciating him for my redemption. That's why people come sometimes and then pray, Father, I just thank you. Lord Jesus, I thank you for redeeming my soul. I thank you for redeeming my life from destruction. I thank you for my salvation. I thank you for the salvation of my brother. I thank you for the salvation of my sister. I thank you for the salvation of this and that and that. Are you with me? But look at what we have got. It's like as if we just came on earth, everything we brought in ourselves from that. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I know when assuming you build a house for somebody that you moves in, even as a tenant, your landlord will visit you and say you are an ingrate. You pay your rent. But say you could not even say, well done, or thank you for this beautiful house. Well, you are looking at this contract, I pay my rent, but say you should appreciate good things. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So I thank you because you sent your Son Jesus Christ to redeem me from eternal destruction. Who sent his only begotten Son to redeem you? So who are you arguing? All this process stated is what? Hallowing God. To hallow and exalt. To magnify. Then bring up after this one now. After thanking him for that redemption, you now bring up the subject, personal subject that you appreciate. Personal subject, not prayer requests yet, though. We have not gotten to our daily bread. It's your daily bread, you cannot ask for 1 million and one request. You cannot ask that God should give you the neck of your enemies if your enemies are up to 1 million. Are you with me? Not that just say, after praise and worship, the first request is, Father, in the name of Jesus, all those who say I will not wear shoes this year, we are kill them. Don't cut their legs, just kill them. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work out that way. It is then you now begin to appreciate. You are appreciating your job that he gave you. You are not appreciating your car that he gave you. If he doesn't give you the life able to work for the money, will you have it? If he doesn't help you to sustain the car, will you sustain it? The fact that your car was not stolen away from you is not because you pay your tithe, it's of the Lord's mercy. It's not because you are committed in church that when I'm brother did not sleep in your house. But it's of his mercy. Is that not so?
Yes.
So in the same that you need to appreciate him for all these things, you appreciate him that you slept and woke up. Never did not take light because you're in Nigeria. You appreciate him that in his mercy, after 19 years, he brought African Cup back to your country. You need to see me on Sunday. That's why I was tired. I prayed from the opening week, from commencement of the match till the final whistle was blown. When it was 5 minutes to the match, it was like 5 hours. Why are you praying? I was praying as a non-believer. The devil told me, said, you know you are going to say they should pray in the morning that they wake up. And he said, Victor will deliver the cup to me. Yeah, if he does not deliver, if he does, if this cup does not come to Nigeria, half of your church is gone. I didn't even remember that the church belongs to Jesus. Quickly, my eyes cleared with full focus and attention. My Father, my God, whatever I've asked you, that you are here to bring this one, this cup of Nigeria. Please come today. One bucket of us to touch for, whether they are enough, he said, hey, Jesus. Praying all manners of uncoordinated prayers at the time. Then I will change the tongue. I will sweat. And then they blew the final whistle. I went on my knees in my room and beat my knees. Because I had to lock myself in the bedroom after. Even the visitors that visited me, they were complaining about their issues. I couldn't give attention. I said, we're watching this match. Why? Because so many things was at stake. What was at stake? A man's ego. Are you with me? That word of if. And that will always push you to feel that things may not work. But we will come into his presence. The psalmist says, I will come into his presence with thanksgiving. A heart of appreciation is a heart of increase. So whatever prayer, even if you are going to do prayer for 30 minutes, even if you do this one for 3 minutes, just look at the book of Genesis at the beginning. He created this, he created that, he created that, he created that, he created that, and there was nothing God created that we could fault. The one we are faulting today are the inventions of men. Praise the Lord. So you now bring those things that you appreciate. When you finish the ones that you appreciate, then pray, oh God, I thank you that yesterday you helped me so much in this way or that way. Now you know why our sin at times is much. Thank God for mercy. When we pray to the point I will remember yesterday, at times you say to yourself, God punished yesterday. You know, you may not say that the way I'm saying it, that God punished yesterday. I said, what was good yesterday? Just like at times, when we remember 2012, I would say, that 2012, I must not come again. It was a bad year. May I not see that 2012 again? The reason is that we never appreciated any yesterday to see the betterment of the new day. He says, in all things, you should do what?
Repentance.
The same yesterday you are talking about, there were many people that were moved to the mortuary. The same yesterday you are complaining about, there were many people who woke up like this and they said, good morning. That was all. There were many people who woke up, not they didn't leave their house. So they just made phone call. After that, right, the phone was not going, they thought it was network. Only to discover their God. And once there is light, there is what? So. And so that our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, is to appreciate him, to thank him, acknowledge him, magnify his name, express your heart about the acceptability of everything he has done. What is thanksgiving? Thanking God for what he has done. So it's not only about what he has done for you now, what you inherited that you meant that he has done. If not for God, this never we are complaining about. Before was there light. Maybe you use matches and you scratch stone against stone in the stone age.
of this God, this God we are complaining about, is it the little food is not us? And only. You know, in the days of key, you know, key, that was the gospel was crazy. The man want to drop from the helicopter, and he thought that God dropped something from the family. And that was the problem. I was almost destroying the unity and peace of the whole community. They had to go and throw it away. In the course of praying, he saw another manifestation of God again. So we have to thank God for God. But we are so encumbered with our challenges at our time. In fact, impossible not to say thank you, Jesus, or thank you, Father. We just start. Even at times till today, some of us don't want to start praying. We just wake up. Ma baraka kaka so kaka to ma kaka kaka la la. Ye trono ba sule me babo. Father, remember that today when I go, I must get transport money back because you know there is no food in the house. Ma room ma manda. God, if you don't give food to this family, I will not come to church on Sunday. Ne praso kala la manda. E la brada basa. I will change church by next week. I will not even go again at all because God, what is my reward? Everybody that came to church after me got job. This is me. I'm still waiting. Ne brada kato la manda. God, you now block me. And at the end of the day, we come again and say, no, I don't know why all these things are happening. Why? Because I lack understanding of the standard they have set. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Did we get something from there?
Yes, sir.
Now let's consider the second part today, so that we'll now practicalize it. In verse number 10, the next stage, I call it stage 2, S2. Stage 1 is hallowing him. So if you now want to do that stage 1, if you decide to do it for 1 hour, 2 hours, you can still be on it. Assuming you want to do 8 hours of praying. If you want to do 1 hour, you can decide to plan it and say, this stage 1, I want to spend 10 minutes. Then you begin to imagine all manner of things God has done. You begin to reconsider when you were young, maybe they wanted to kill you. Maybe you took poison mistakenly, and God medically you survived, or God just miraculously did something in your life. When we look at our life, there have been always the way of escape even before we were saved. But have we ever appreciated God for that, those times? Now, stage 2, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's the next verse, verse 10. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Only through the cross of Jesus Christ, the kingdom of heaven has successfully infiltrated the kingdom of Satan. So when his kingdom came, what happened to the kingdom of darkness? The kingdom of light came. Jesus is the light that lightens the life of all men. Is that not so? When he came, he went down to the Hades, took the key of hell and of age, of death, from the devil. He made an open show of him. Colossians 2, verses 14 and 15. Revelation 1:18, he took the key of death. Now he was dead, but now alive. So if somebody says, I'm afraid that Satan can kill me, Satan has no more the key of death. Who has it?
Jesus.
So most times we accredit power to who power the Lord does not belong to. Two, Jesus died at Calvary and shed his blood. Through that incident, he infiltrated a sin-filled world with forgiveness and righteousness and took away the enmity between God and mankind. So, what I'm establishing here is the process and the right, the authority he has to enforce his kingdom on earth. So, where seems to be struggle, hardship, pain, darkness, the establishment of his kingdom is his primary motive. That is why Jesus came. So, the depravity of man, what is separating God and man, he came to settle that score. Now, if Nigeria and the Republic, they are fighting, and Ban Ki-moon, who is the United Nations Secretary, now come on behalf of the United Nations, you know, he's representing the recognized authority, and he comes and the treaty is established, and then he now wins the treaty in favor of Nigeria. Now, whatever the issue is, what has Ban Ki-moon done on behalf of the United Nations? What has he